results of my collaboration with, also with Timon de Haas, that he's also based at the University of Cologne, and unfortunately he wasn't able to be here today. The motivation for this collaboration, at least in my part, was because I wanted to see how we can best use minimal computational models to study long-term settlement evolution. Minimal in terms of the assumptions of the model, but also the data sets that are used in these models. And I have used these kinds of models in the past also to study the relationship between spatial and social organization in prehistoric Crete in a period that was very much debated. And in some sense, the result seemed too good to be true, considering also how fragmentary was my data set, and this raised a lot of questions of in which other situations these approaches could be useful. So I think the data that Timon and his colleagues have collected from the Pontine region can perhaps help us answer such questions. So the models I'm referring to belong to a special class of computational models that are known as special interaction models. These models range from simple gravity models that were introduced in the 70s to much more sophisticated computer simulations that they have been developed in the last 10 years or so. At a very basic level, these models aim to explore the evolution of settlement hierarchies and also the emergence of central settlements, the settlement distribution. So they help us identify important sites within a certain region. And so far, they have been used in many different cultural contexts with a relatively high degree of success, such for example in classical Greece, in Bronze Age Aegean, in Bronze Age Crete, in Iron Age, Bronze Age Syria, in Bronze Age Iraq, and so on. And in some of these cases, as I mentioned earlier, these models have also been used with a very fragmentary data set. Nonetheless, the behavior of the model in these situations is not very clear. My aim in this case was to see to what degree we can use minimal data input and have still successful results. Also, another aspect of this model is that they're usually validated with comparison to known site sizes. Of course, if we have very fragmentary data sets our archaeological record is not well preserved, it's quite often the case that we don't know site sizes. So one of the questions here is whether we could use other types of evidence to validate these models. In the past, for example, we have used artifact distributions, but there might be also other evidence if we have a very contextually rich record. And lastly, a question that arises, how successful are these models in different socio-political contexts? For example, what types of economic strategies best conform with the model results, and in which situation the model becomes less useful? And I think the data that have been collected from the Pontine region can help us answer these questions. The Pontine region is located 50 kilometers south of Rome, and has been intensively surveyed mainly by the University of Groningen and the Pontine Region Project for at least the last 30 years. There have been also many different subphases in the survey, and overall 33 square kilometers have been surveyed only by the University of Groningen, there have been also additional surveys in this area where you can see the parts that have been surveyed in red here. This is the study area. And you can see also from the slides that there are many parts that have not been investigated very intensively. Nonetheless, this data give us still an unusually well-contextualized archaeological record, despite the fact that it's quite patchy. And we have data from the Archaic until the Imperial period that ranges from 600 BC until 250 AD. Now, in the past, as is often the case in Roman archaeology, research has focused mainly on understanding the relationship between the cities and the territories, but more recently, attention has been paid to smaller central places, what Timon and his colleagues call the minor centers, and these are sites that they're not very well investigated always. They are sites that are not necessarily urban, but nonetheless they have certain central functions that have been identified by archaeological, epigraphic and textual evidence. Also, we're not sure about the size of the settlements. Some of them could have been quite large, but in some cases we don't have a site estimation. Also, some of these centers are close to or are to be found along Rome known streets. So, recently Timon has tried to classify the type of function this kind of minor centers have to administrative, religious, that are, for example, suggested by the presence of temples and sanctuaries, social, organizational, commercial, that are suggested by foreign taberne, crafts and constructions, infrastructure, suggested by the presence of streets, of course, and defensive. And there's not exact correlation between site size and the number of factions or the type of factions. Mostly, like large sites have many factions and small sites have fewer factions, but it's often the case that you have a large site with a couple of factions and small sites with more factions, and this might suggest an investigation bias. So we cannot, in this case, use the number or type of factions as exact proxy of settlement size, but still these are data on centrality, and you can use it at least in some cases to validate the model, because they tell us something about the nature of the site and how they were used. And another question that we perhaps can answer with this data set is whether the model can make likely predictions on the emergence of central places in the different periods I mentioned, in the Archaic, Republican and Imperial, given the fact that these periods are characterized by different rural economies. So, a few things about the model. I'm using a special interaction model that was introduced by Alan Wilson in the 70s. This model is used here to simulate interaction between the settlements in the Pontine region, the three different periods I mentioned, so to understand the emergence of central places in this area. Now, how we run the model? Well, the first thing you need is a group of sites that represent the settlement distribution in a certain period, then links between the sites are created, and then flows between these sites are estimated, and flows in this case suggest a composite of interaction between the settlements. They can be, for example, intensity of trade along different routes, daily or seasonal journey to work, or the permanent migration of people. And the distribution of flows in this model is determined by this formula here, that basically says that an amount of flow that originates from site I will be shared with another site J, based on how attractive is that site J. That is something that is suggested by its size, but also taking into account all other sites in the model, their distance, and also their attractiveness. So to give you an idea how this kind of simulation runs, at the beginning of each simulation, all sites are equal in size, and as long as the simulation runs, the sites that are closer to other sites increase in size, and as they increase in size, they attract flows even more strongly. And in the end, we have an equilibrium situation, which is the results is what you see here, where what you see in blue is what we call terminal, is where the location where a central place would have been expected. So there are two important parameters in the model, alpha and beta. Alpha suggests how strongly a site attracts flows in proportion to its size and better suggests how much distance affects communication. Eh? So this is basically a simple distance model that has also a rich, getting richer function eh? That is suggested based on how big are the sites. Now, obviously in this case, you would need a complete settlement distribution to run this model successfully. This is hardly the case with archaeological datasets, and definitely not the case with the Pontine region. Just to remind you that this is in red are the survey area, so all this area here is not as well investigated, and this of course creates bias. We should expect missing sites from our distribution, either because this in areas that have not been surveyed, or because this missing site have not survived. So to account for these missing sites, this spatial interaction model is combined with a computer simulation that predicts the likely location of missing sites within a 2.5 kilometer area from agricultural land, and also in a regular spacing that is here 4 kilometers. So what happens here is that we run the model many times, and every time we use a different data input, a different distribution that consists of known sites and also these simulated sites, and the location of the simulation sites changes before each simulation run. So in the end, we actually interpret the results statistically perhaps sometimes using density map, such as the one you see here, where what you see in red and yellow are the locations where these central places are likely to emerge. In this particular model also we take into account overseas interactions, so in periods where we have intense maritime trade, we also take into account that coastal sites, port cities would have received additional flows from overseas, and again in this case these flows are distributed in proportion to the size of these port towns. So let's see some of the results for these three periods I mentioned. So these are the results of the archaic period, which actually for this period we have only 22 sites, which is a very, very low site number for this kind of model. I mean, I don't know another application of this model with so few sites, but normally this model is applied with site numbers that range between 30 and 400, for example. So this is a very minimal, as I say, data set. And we see that in the archaic period, settlement is basically extends in all three areas of the landscape, the uplands, the inner plain, and also the coastal area. And we have the largest sites in the uplands and in the inner plain, but also have smaller centers distributed also on the coast and so on. So in this case, the model results are not very successful. The model predicts the likely locations of the two known larger settlements in Karakupa and Satricum. So this is matches what we know for this data set. But at the same time, the smaller sites are missed by this application. So, for example, Velletri, Caprifico would also have been a large site, also Anzio here, but they don't show up in the model results. So, in this case, I don't consider the application of the model as successful as I have seen in previous applications, and the reason for this might be the low site number. Okay, or it might be also that the model assumptions don't conform very well with conditions that gave rise to settlement to the settlement growth in this particular case. But actually, it's hard to know in this case. In the Republican period, we have 34 sites in the distribution, which is not as, I mean, it's the model has proved successful. In the past with such that kind of site numbers, and settlement this period is mainly concentrated in the upland areas where we have also the largest sites, and in this case what we know is probably that these cities actually, which are these urban centers, were founded under because of military considerations. So basically they are Roman colonies in contested areas. So again, if we see how the model predicts, or if whether the model can predict this kind of settlement distribution and the location of central places, then we notice again that the results of the model are not very successful. Actually, the model predicts the location of the largest settlement here, which is Norba, but at the same time, it misses the locations of Kora and Sete, which have been sizable settlements, like above 15 hectares, and also have two centers in Lanuvio and Valletri. That kind of, I mean, you have a central place in between the sites, but I think the prediction and the distance between the likely location of this large site and the distance of the actual settlement is not as small as we would expect for this kind of model, for a successful application of this kind of model. And in this case, you can say that perhaps the reason why the model results don't match very well, or it's not as good as we have expected, they don't match very well with the archaeological record, is because the model assumptions do not perform very well with the factors that determine settlement growth in this case. Sites here grew because, or were found because of military considerations rather than interaction and trade maximizing strategies that is that are can be best predicted by this model. Now, the results of the Imperial period are somewhat different. So, in this case, we have the creation of big ports at the coast, and in this period, this area of the Pontine region is much better integrated in the international maritime networks. And as a result, also these port towns become the largest settlements in this region. And at the same time, we have the emergence of smaller centers, what are called at the beginning the minor centers, that take over central functions from the sites in the uplands where that they decline in this period. And the model results in this case seem much more, seem to fit much better what we know from the archaeological record. This is the results that we have even if we don't consider maritime interactions in this case. So we have large settlements where we would expect them to be, normally Nancio, Astura. Also here in the coast is another site with no name actually, but it should have been like 30 hectares, one of the largest sites in the region. Also Lanuvio. And at the same time, we start to see the emergence or the model seems to predict the likely location of central places in locations where we have the minor centers. So here actually is the Tre Taberne. This is a site that we have important commercial functions. At this area here is the area where the results are most contingent, more uncertain, we can say. And this is why you can see here low site densities. The reason why the results are certain is because we have a very low site density in this case. So it's not the probabilities of having a large center is not as high as we have in other areas here. But still, the model seems to suggest that Sete would have a likely advantage here. This is also a large site, and also sites close to the coast that in this case we know that we have a large site here or and here as well. And if we take into account the overseas interactions, we see also that these patterns become even more strong. Sites close to the coast again seem much more likely, and also the inner plane where Forum Appii, another minor center, would have located, seems to gain again an advantage. In fact, we know that the site would have been actually quite sizable. So, as when we start having maritime integration, at the same time, we see that the location and the emergence of minor centers in this case becomes much more likely. So, to conclude, to sum up a bit the results, in the archaic period, the model estimates correctly only the locations of the two largest settlements, but the results don't match very well the smaller sites. And in this case, the problem might be low site numbers, or it might even be that the modeling assumptions do not conform well with the socio-political consideration of this period, but we cannot be very sure in this case. But I think probably it's the low site numbers in this case. In the Republican period, again, with minimal number of sites, the results are not very satisfactory. And this is mainly because the actual large centers in this period were very likely founded primarily on the basis of strategic military considerations and not because of trade maximizing strategies and an intention to increase interaction between settlements that is much better the model assumptions. The results are much better for the imperial period, which in this case you have the likely location of many of the large settlements, and in this case we also see the emergence of the smaller center places that take many factions of the that take many factions of the uplands of the settlements that used to be in the uplands. So I think the results in the model in this case tell us something about how we can understand something about the process of how these settlements emerged in the end. So yeah, I think I should stop, so I just respect the rules. Yes, I think more or less this is what I need to say, but thank you very much.